So I'm talking about lutein and inflammation, but before I start, let me acknowledge the people who did all the work, particularly Yuan Tian in the middle, who was having a poster and giving a talk this afternoon, and this work has been sponsored. This is about AMD, which I'm talking about, and this is, if you live in Holland and Amsterdam, the end stage of AMD, as you all may know, and there are possible risk factors: age, genetics, where I will dwell upon, smoking, gender, but in particular this meeting is about nutrition, so that's what my talk is also about. And I'm in the field. I started in ophthalmology, being a physicist, in 1992, and I'm looking at macular pigments since 1995 or 4 or so, when John Seddon published this paper looking at food frequency diet questionnaires, where she found out that if you people having a lot of spinach, carrots, have an odds ratio which is less than one for having a macular AMD. And if you then look what's the main cause, that's lutein, which doing the job. So then you think, how about lutein? Well, since then, a lot of studies have been done on lutein. It started with the field. Well, John showed us an overview of the people, of the papers having lutein in it. So that was, let's say, the start of the field. I mentioned a few. This is the ARID study, which looked also at lutein. Obviously, it was not designed to look at lutein, but they could, they did anyhow, by looking at the baseline results. And they said higher dietary intake of lutein and zinc tendons was independently associated with increased likelihood of having AMD. And this is a paper from the Rotterdam study, where they also look at diet, not supplements, just diet. They divided their group into three. Is this the pointer? Yes, it is. So the lowest thertile and the highest thertile, and they compared carriers for the CFH. And obviously, when you have a homozygous, then you have much more risk to have AMD. But look what happens if you're in the highest quartile. For some reason, you seem to be able to eat your risk away. So in particular in this group, lutein is beneficial. So then this is the ARID study, not designed to look at lutein, but then the ARID study 2 was started, which is a very complicated design, hard to explain. But for the purpose of this talk, let's just look how you can also look at this. It's in a kind of factorial design. Lutein and zeaxanthin and omega-3 fatty acids, only the omegas and vice versa. And although in a primary analysis, lutein was not effective, if you do a kind of second analysis, then you see that lutein is effective. Without going into much detail, Emily Chu talked about this 2 years ago in detail. Many tables are in this paper, and they all look like this: favors lutein, zeaxanthin. Favors lutein, zeaxanthin. So indeed, lutein is effective in AMD, in preventing AMD, or in some way. So how come? When this results were presented at ARVO, I asked this question also, and the answer was, we are epidemiologists and we don't care. It's just as it is. But that's why my interest, they really aren't, it's really the answer. But, well, that's what my interest is. So one of the things is macular pigments, obviously. It's the yellow spot in your fovea. This may come by many times, this conference, where it is, because Max Nolly gave this to all of us. Here it is, the macular pigment, just before the photoreceptors in your fovea. It acts as a blue light filter. Here's the absorbance spectra. So it's here it's bluish, greenish, reddish, and it absorbs the blue light. And this is maybe beneficial. This is lipofuscin. It's a waste product which accumulates during lifetime. It's hardly visible at 9 years, but if you get older and older, in all of us, it accumulates. And this lipofuscin, the part of it which is called A2E, if you illuminate it with blue light, then it gets very toxic. So diminishing the blue light exposure by having a blue filter like lutein may be very beneficial in vision. Then it's also, lutein seems is also able to scavenge free radicals, and that's also important. Let's look at cones and rods, more in detail here, like the schematic. The visual pigments are in these disks or infolds, and these are is kind of bilayer, and the lutein it perfectly fits in these bilayers. They have some structural integrity, which I heard this morning, which may be very good to have them in. But they, but they also are in place to protect, because in this bilayer a lot of DHA is present, which is very prone to oxidative damage. So these are two possible mechanisms. But the one I preferably want to talk about is the inhibitor of inflammation. This is there was some indications that indeed lutein can inhibit inflammation. This is an endotoxin-induced uveitis in a rat model. And if you look at markers for inflammation, then you see that if you increase the lutein doses, then you decrease the number of infiltrating cells and other markers for inflammation. Similar in a choroidal neovascularization mouse model, having lutein increased the markers for inflammation. And another paper from Wendy Brugmans, who looked at endothelial function inflammation, also markers for inflammation, like the CECAM, were lower in by lutein. This is a regression coefficients, which you see here, or flow-mediated vasodilation, which are lower if you look at zeaxanthin. So there seems to be some anti-inflammatory effect of lutein, which we summarized it in this paper some years ago. So how about AMD and inflammation? Because AMD, that's why I started with. Well, if you look at early AMD, then markers are drusen, these little white spots. These are biomarkers. So if you have these spots and if they increase, then you are more prone to develop age-related macular degeneration. So people looked at this drusen, and what they found were, this is in the blue, C3A, C5A, to be present in huge amount in this drusen, and these are components of the complement system, whereas they were not present in subjects having a no AMD. These are AMD subjects. Also in the RPE, in particular at this A2E where I talked about, complement activation could be demonstrated. So this triggered people to look at the complement system, and papers were published showing that CFH was very prominent predictor for AMD, which resulted in highly cited papers. This is another paper from the Rotterdam study showing this similarly, that if you have a carrier, then your risk, your cumulative incidence, so your risk of having AMD is increases dramatically. Well, here is many genes have been found since then, since this CFH gen is being found, but they are not the reddish on this axis is the odds ratio. They are not have not a high odds ratio as has this CFH and this CFB genes. And these genes are all related to the complement system. So the complement system is very important in AMD. So there are three ways, pathways in the complement effect, and it's the alternative pathway that we should look at, which is here schematically. There is the complement factor H. It's a kind of negative control. So if you you need this to as a kind of to have this cycle modest, because if you don't, then you end up with a lot of this membrane attack complex, and this will eventually destroy your cells. So if for some reason, by well having not the proper SNPs, this GFH does not work properly, then you end up with too much membrane attack complex. That's not only in the eye, but sometime later, Scholl and co-workers found that there is also some systemic complement activation being found. Factors associated with this complement system I showed you, factor D, C5A, C3, remember these were found in drusen, and this is the membrane attack complex, are significantly higher in AMD subjects compared to controls. This is a paper from the Nijmegen group showing the same. So I thought, well, if lutein has a kind of inflammation, anti-inflammatory effect, and if this inflammation is so involved in AMD, why not look at this and see whether this is possible to study this? Happily, I had some blood in a freezer from an intervention study. I'm sure this is published, where we looked at lutein over a one-year time period. Well, as you may appreciate, this is the baseline results, macular pigment. Final visit, macular pigment goes up, whereas in the placebo group it does not. So it showed, as it should, an increase in macular pigment. Because as you know, we cannot make lutein ourselves. We need it from diet. So if you increase your diet, then your macular pigment increases. But also it shows a visual acuity change. This is logma. So downwards is increases in visual acuity significant between the lutein group and the placebo group. So this is a study which we could use, which shows an effect. And also in a kind of dose-dependent way, the amount of change in MPUD correlates with a change in visual acuity. And we are not the only ones who found this. Last year, a review came out from Wang and colleagues, which summarizes the results up to far, and they all favor lutein in a kind of visual acuity change. And even more recent, Liu, in 2015, came up with another overview, small review, adding some more. This is our paper, by the way, showing that indeed, if you supplement with lutein, then your visual acuity changes. And also in a kind of dose-dependent way, change in visual acuity depends on the change in macular pigment, or put it a little bit different here, it's a lutein dose supplement. It seems to, in a rather dose-dependent way, change in visual acuity. So lutein, the question was asked, do we need lutein? Well, maybe you need lutein for your visual acuity. Obviously, visual acuity is not needed in when you are hunting or seeing animals in a forest, but it may be needed for visual acuity. I had a preliminary look at a large data set from the Rotterdam study, which I collected, and also there I see some correlation between macular pigment optical density and visual acuity. So back to this blood levels, which I had in the freezer, and to this factor D, C5A, C3D. What we did is we had two groups, a placebo group and a lutein group, and we measured these three component factors. At baseline, they were not different, but look what happens over time. It's really a dramatic effect. This is the complement factor D, the placebo group, and the lutein group. This is our relative changes. An increase of more than 50%. And if you look more downstream, then there's a C5A and C3D, they all go down. And also in a kind of way which you expect, if C5D goes down, and then C5A goes down, and also 3B. And that's because complement factor D, that's a kind of positive control. It's present in small amounts, but if you have too much of this complement factor D, then this whole process will speed up and eventually lead to a lot of membrane attack on plaque, which is harmful. So you rather have it controlled. It is not in MD subject, as he saw before, but with lutein, you can decrease the complement factor D. We then decided also to have a final look at this membrane attack complex, and also here we saw the same change for the better in the lutein group, and if anything, worsening in the placebo group over time, and a change in C5A, which is in this cascade just before the final membrane attack complex, is associated with the change in this membrane attack complex itself. The black dots are the subjects on lutein, and the open ones are in the placebo group. So, this is this positive rate limiting control. You can lower it, and then downstream everything is lowered. People try to, in particular, to look at geographic atrophy, so not the let's say the dry form of AMD. To look for therapies, and this is a table which I got from a paper which was rejected on lampalizumab, showing attempts to look at the complement pathway. And for instance, this component was a C3 blockade. This C5 blockade, they all failed. Only one, which is now in a phase 2, the factor T blockade, C showed some effect, although if you look at this retracted paper, it was not too big an effect. But anyhow, factor D block factor D may be beneficial, but you don't need such an approach. Just have lutein. That would be the message of this talk. Well, then comes the question: how come? Why does lutein act on complement factor D? Well, factor D, as it's called now, it's also called adipsin because it's produced in adipocytes. So we thought, well, maybe we should have a look at adipocytes, and happily we had a kind of human cell line of adipocytes in our lab where we had a look at. These are cell lines which then Yuan Tian looked at, and she added lutein to these cell lines. And here I stop because Yuan Tian was one of the poster presenters, which was invited to give a talk this afternoon. So she will go on and present you these results. So let me finish with my conclusions, which are lutein significantly decreases the circulating levels of the complement factors, as I've shown you, and it offers a simple method to control the inflammatory pathway of the innate immune system, which may be a very beneficial way to protect AMD, and which may be one of the pathways why lutein is being found in this ARDS2 study, to be beneficial. And remember, these were well-fed Americans, which already had their ARDS formula, and even on top, and even then, lutein seemed to have a beneficial effect. So the final message is, please come back this afternoon and hear the follow-up on this talk. I'm still in the green, but I think then people after me can take some more time, and I'm happy to take questions.
We have some questions from the floor. David.
When you find activation of the complement system, do you also find increased activation of other more conventional markers of inflammation?
No.
CRP?
We look at CRP and they are not elevated. They're not influenced by lutein. But these markers, these are very specific for AMD. And this CRP, for instance, this is a kind of general mark of inflammation.
Okay, thank you.
No effect of lutein on it. No.
Congratulations to that nice study. Do you have also thought about performing experiments with retinal pigment epithelial cells and just to activate with, for example, A2E, and then to lower down this activation of the complement system by lutein supplementation?
This has been done, actually, mm-hmm. and its positive effects has been shown. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The mechanism which you describe and anti-inflammatory, do you think that has significance for what we'll be talking about tomorrow with respect to brain health and cognitive function?
I think so, yeah. Might be also be a pathway.
Because I know that there's various mechanisms and different...
A word of caution, though, we try to replicate our results by a study from Austria. Leopold Smetterer, he did send his samples over to Maastricht and we analyzed them. But we could not find the result, but that's because they were not properly stored. If you take a serum, you have to store it immediately in the freezer at minus 80, because if you do not do so, then the complement activation is already ongoing and you're out of business. So it would be good to have this replicated, obviously.
But
we could not. So if you want to do this, and many studies are going to start on brain function also, where blood will be taken, please take care that you can do this properly by having it in the freezer quickly.
Last question, Stuart.
One of the troubling issues for a clinician is suggesting what to do in terms of geographic atrophy after the ARIDS 2 study. And in those eyes, the eyes were older and sicker eyes. And nonetheless, adding the lutein zeaxanthin to the original ARIDS formula did not have as dramatic an effect in ARIDS 2 as compared to ARIDS 1.
Right.
So in that context, do you believe that maybe increasing the dose, since these were older and sicker eyes and this has a powerful effect on the complement system, would increasing the dose of the carotenoids be appropriate for these older and sicker eyes in ARIDS 2? As people got older and sicker, it didn't seem to make any difference with geographic atrophy.
I don't think increasing the dose will increase, no. I don't think it's no need to increase the dose above the 10 milligrams.
So isn't there a point where you're not going to get an effect?
The Americans which you see are not the Americans from the ARIDS 2 study. Your first study, the veterans which are low on diet and have a smoke, and they benefit, I think they would benefit more than these ARIDS 2 subjects. So I would
at
just...
early stages, yeah.
Yeah, you should start early.
But I have a lot of patients reaching 85 and above, and they're not helped as much as the younger patients. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, well, prevention, that's the word. You shouldn't,
Let's thank our speaker again.